My name is Itzik, and this is my colleague Tomer, and we're going to present to you here tonight about software object exploitation. This lecture will cover the what, the who, the why of this attack, and we will also give you some hands-on and demo about this sweet attack. Okay, so updates. I guess everybody heard about software updates. It ain't nothing new. Your application, my application, everybody does updates these days. Over the time, different updates techniques. You can see here below some of the favorites update methods. Nowadays, most of the people, most of the companies, vendors simply put their updates on the website, and the application downloads the update and simply updates themselves. The reason we picked an update is because the scenario which an update takes place is very ideal and comfortable for exploitation. In addition, when exploiting an update technique, the result is, in many of the times, is that multiple applications become vulnerable at once. Okay. The first requirement to exploit a software update technique is to be able to pull a man-in-the-middle attack on the victim. Now, you can see there's a variety of ways to pull this technique. The only real obstacles that we will see, and later on we will see how we're going to dismiss this obstacle, is the usage of static or predefined URLs, which makes the application very strict. But as I said, it's no match. The second requirement to exploit a software update technique is to don't know the dialect between the update technique, sorry, the update agent and the update server. Now, this is a very specific information, and it's been conducted and gathered per application. What you see over here is a very generic dialect that we've picked up from a survey. The first one, as you can see, is composed from two interactions. The application goes online, checking with the site whatever it's currently been up to date. If it's not been up to date, it expects the server to supply a roadmap of versions and URLs to download them from. Now, as you can see, there are two failing points in this dialect. First, we can always reply with a negative answer. That means even if the client is really updated, you will think it's not. Second of all, when the update will proceed to download the update, we can then manipulate the URL and set it to be our own. The second dialect is much more simpler. The application is not the vendor site, pre-programmed. It simply goes straight forward and download executable. Well, in this case, what we will show later on is it is possible to redirect or reroute the request from reaching the vendor site and actually make it go to our own website. Okay, so let's start the attack. What you can see here is the layer 4 and the layer 3 of the attack. On the layer 3 basis, we're not doing anything interesting, simply inverting the IP addresses. On the layer 4, we do have something very interesting. As you can see, as usual, we compete the sequence, the checksums, the basics. But we're also going to pull what we call a one-shot, one-kill trick. The one-shot, one-kill trick is implemented in TCP. And the idea is that most of the updates dialects takes place within a single packet frame, which means for us, it only takes to transmit one packet to the victim, and we will push aside the real server. Now, as you can see, we are going to activate the push, ACK, and FIN bits. The push and ACK is used to transfer the information to the application. But the FIN is to state that the application has finished talking, no more information to be sent. What it will happen as when the real server will wake up and give the reply, I recall that is a man in the middle, and we're actually going to perform it on the Wi-Fi environment, we cannot actually mute the server for real. It will come back with an answer. But since we've signaled the FIN bit, the retransmission or the server actual reply will be disqualified as TCP out of state. So, this is her idea for a one-shot, one-kill. On a much higher scale, what we saw is most of the applications are actually using HTTP to conduct their business. This makes an update just a regular HTTP transaction. Here you can see a list of a very popular and common interactive in HTTP. For instance, the client accessing a document, perhaps an XML or an INI. The result is this, a client expects some kind of a roadmap with versions, with URLs to download from. We can counter this or poison this by supplying our own document, which will, of course, be malicious with a malicious URL included. We can see that when the client proceeds into downloading the file directly, regardless for anything, we can do a nice trick, and it's to basically counter it with an HTTP 302 response. Now, HTTP protocol supports redirection on the fly. It supports load balancing and transparent operations. So when the application actually accessing a file, trying to download it, will actually redirect the request saying that the file exists, merely just on another different server. A demo of this attack will be presented later, and you will see for yourself. Either way, the server will be muted. As explained in the layer 4 technique, we have nothing that we can add on this layer to basically overrun the server reply, of course. Okay, so our idea of attack is basically to spoof the update server reply. We're going to do it by pulling a man-in-the-middle attack on the victim, and in the right moment, we're going to inject a single packet, if possible, that will contain a document that says a newer version available, this is the URL for it, or B, we will try to redirect or relocate download from taking place on the vendor side to take place on our malicious repository. So let's start seeing some real-life case studies, and we will begin with Notepad++, a very straightforward application and a very straightforward update technique. The application begins by performing a very simple GET query. You can see that the application actual version is being passed as a URI parameter for that 9.2. The application expects an XML from the server stating whether there's a higher version to update, and if there is, which URL it should be take to download it. So, when we know about this, and we know how the XML look alike, it's very easy for us to generate on the fly such an XML with the response, with the proper format and syntax, basically stating A, there is a higher version, and we can easily compete a higher version from the current performed URI pass parameter. Second of all, knowing that we can cause an update to take place, we can also set the URL to be anywhere in the world. In that case, we will of course take it home to our malicious server. So, what's the result? The result is a very naive application doing a very naive approach, just trying to see whether there is a new version available, it ended up downloading a malware on the updated computer. And it did so quite fast. The second application that we're going to review is Skype. Skype, on the other hand, does not use such a naive approach. It's actually accessing the same URL to download the file, skypesetup.exe. Now, the skypesetup.exe file is basically determined in runtime whether an update is required or not. So, we cannot stop Skype from making the download, and we cannot actually make Skype make the download from a different location. We have to actively work against download. So, in this very specific case, and in the case where the application goes straight forward, head in the wall, don't care, don't ask, to a website, what we're going to do is we're going to counter this action with HTTP 302 response code. The HTTP 302 response code allows us to basically define a new location where the resource is being located. So, when Skype approach download.skype.com, asking whatever skypesetup.exe is available, we're going to respond with, hell yeah, it's available. Only it's just moved a little bit to the evil repository side. And Skype will just go there happily ever after, download the file and execute it. Question that people ask me many times is whatever fixed parameters or all sort of pre-shared knowledge about the server can be effective. So as you guys saw, there are any fixed parameters, any fixed host names or whatever you like to call it, is really not match. In the example of Skype, we have proven that even the application knows the location and knows what it's after. Thanks to the HTTP protocol flexibility, it's made it easy for us to basically redirect it again and downloading a malware instead. Okay, the last example that we're going to review is a much complex one. The Malwarebytes application is an open source anti-malware application. And its update procedure is a little bit complex, but not that much. First, it begins by querying the server whether there's a higher version available. Notice here that the application never reports about its current version. No worry about it. We can always fake a much higher version or the highest possible version. If the server do contain a much higher version, it will simply go and download, again, a fixed file name from a fixed site. So, that's how we're going to do it. In this specific update procedure, we can choose to do either one of the two. We can either try and always spin the download itself, which means we will make it reliable with the user. He will always try to download a real version, except he will receive a malware instead. And we can also choose another technique, which will be to fight on both fronts. In this example, we choose to fight on both fronts. For the first get, we're going to answer with a fake higher version. As you can see, the highest possible number the application accepts. So, the application will proceed further to download the actual update. Okay, again, a fixed name, fixed location, no worry about it. We're going to spin it off with HTTP response 302. The result is, even when an application performs a much complexer dialect and has more than one query, it is still possible to hijack it successfully and exploit it to run malwares. We have collected a little bit over 100 different applications. We went to download.com, other major websites, taking everything from image viewers, CD players, shitty applications, really. We just went to everything that we can, and we collected a pretty big database. You can see some examples below here for different type of application which are vulnerable. I think it's a very good time to proceed to some real life action. Tomer?
Hey, everybody. So before the demo, we just want to take a minute and explain you what components builds our attack. So what we have here are two computers. One is the attacker computer. Our attack tool, EPON, is running on it. And the second one is the victim computer. This is the computer that will try to do the update. In addition, we also have here an access point. It's an open public Wi-Fi called MedWi-Fi. Also, the attacker and the victim computer are connected through it. Because we had to do some changes in the setup, we will demonstrate the demo on the VMware because we do have two screens, but it's one feed, so we will not be able to see also the attacker and the victim. So let's begin. First, we need to run EPON. Okay, so what we see here is EPON. EPON has two modes, a CLI mode and a 3D mode. We are watching the 3D mode. We are watching the 3D mode. The 3D mode is like a Wi-Fi radar. What we can see here that we are the yellow vertex, the main vertex, and surrounding us, all other blue vertexes, right now it's only MedWi-Fi, are all available access points that EPON was able to detect. The GUI also supports zooming in, zooming out, and rotating.